you think of the science in that's going on in the film? What do you think of this particular approach?
I'm going to let the scientist answer that question. I'm an English major.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm not running away from answering that, but I want to take a vote here, okay? And listen very well to what I'm asking you. I'm going to ask who are in favor of being immortalized, or you know, whatever you want to call it. And then I'll give another option, okay? And the option is, we're not going to change your lifespan, but we're going to see that you're healthy pretty much until the day that you die. Those are the two options. Those of you that want to be, that want to believe in this immortalization thing, please raise your hands, and everybody looks around. Okay, I think that's really interesting. And those of you, maybe there are a lot of abstaining, but those of you who want to live your, you know, just want to live healthy, whatever age it is, want to live healthy. Okay, that's very interesting. So, and then a follow-up question, and then
wait,
I'll answer it.
Do you get to decide when you die?
You'll ask this question. Okay. Several of you raise your hands. So let's go to this Oxford meeting, right? And the point of not of Aubrey, but of Dr. I forgot his name.
Blakemore.
He said, you know, our universe cannot sustain immortalization. So let me give you another option. Let me give you an option that now every one of you can live forever, but there's a price. No more babies are born. We're going to totally stop the exchange between reproduction and longevity, okay? No more babies are born. That means, you know, not first love and not first cry and not first baby born. We're done, okay? We're done.
Not only you, but your children can't have babies. Nobody can have babies.
Right. Who's in favor of that? Anyone? Okay. What's wrong? You're not sleeping at night with the babies. Okay. So okay. We clarified that because those are real issues, and those are the things that we are talking about aging. But.
But I mean.
Please.
The immortalization is never going to happen. I mean, let's just stipulate that is a biological impossibility. I'm an English major, but I took biology classes. And I took a course from this guy, too, at the beginning of my research. But, I mean, that's such a far-fetched, extreme goal. I mean, you can't ever see that actually happening.
I thought I'm taking this view and you're taking the other view. I'm totally confused now. I agree with you. I think you can intervene with aging. So let me just make really, I don't want to talk about biology much, but I want to talk about to say two things. As you heard very clearly, Aubrey is not a biologist. He's an engineer. He's done theoretical sciences. He has not an academic degree. And when people are asking me, and you did it also, you said, what do you think about Aubrey? People are coming to me and say, what do you think about Aubrey? Do you go to any doctor that you know and ask about your physiotherapist? We're not in the same profession, really. Okay, so I don't know what to say. Aubrey, when we scientists are talking and we're talking about what happened in our lab, we understand the difficulties, the conditions, the repetition, the validation, and he doesn't understand that. So he can be theoretical, but there's no important biology in some of the things he's saying. With Bill, it happened to be different, okay? With Bill, he believed that extending those telomeres, it was explained very, very nice, that lengthening the telomeres, that expressing this telomerase will be useful for the cells and will be useful for the body But we all know, and Audrey said it very clearly, and we all know, it causes cancer. When you do it in mice, it causes cancer. You can actually get an extension of health if you do two things. You express this telomerase, and you suppress you overexpress tumor suppressors, P53. If you suppress the ability to do tumor, you get longer life, but if you express only tumor suppressor, you get aging very fast. In other words, it's really very complicated. You can do several things and do something. But what Bill failed for is for the science, okay? That's why the investors didn't come. We know that the science is not right. Get another theory. That's what we have to do all the time.
So let me ask you something that comes up in Bill's book, where you're talking about the work that you do around people who have become close to 100 years old. And one of the things one of the really striking things that Bill wrote about what you said is that that people who frequently show up in your office as part of your study, who are almost 100 years old, frequently haven't been to a doctor at all in a long time. And it makes you wonder about what the function of medicine is. It makes you, well, he said that you said something more provocative, like you think that doctors are killing them. Not killing them, but killing other people who don't live to that age.
Right, and you know, the previous president of Israel, Shimon Peres, who's 92 years old, gave the following advice. Listen carefully to what your doctor is saying, so that when you recognize signs of aging in him, exchange him. Take another one. And so it's true that we have to be careful of doing no harm. But I want to make one point and show you how science is being misinterpreted in the public. Because when a Nobel Prize was given to several scientists who did the telomerase and telomere study, Elizabeth Blackburn, she mentioned our study where we showed that centenarians have long telomeres, longer than 80 years old, and also their children have long telomeres. And that was interpreted as that's what's causing aging. But this is an association study. Our view is if you're healthy, you have long telomeres. And if you're sick, you have shorter telomeres. And when telomerase was knocked out first at Einstein by Rhonda Pino, I was in the next lab, and the first thing that I did was go and see if those mice are aging rapidly, because that's what they should have been doing. And no, they have lived absolutely normal life. In order to get short life with that, you have to get the sperms to have very short telomeres, and then they freak up and you get offspring that are old. But the biology is really very complicated and not supportive of that.
So it's sort of like shortened telomeres are almost like a symptom rather than a...
Oh, a marker, maybe a biomarker.
A marker, yeah. Not something that's driving aging.
Mm-hmm. I hate to go back to the comment that Bill wrote in his book, but you say, for example, that statins are something that are being widely prescribed that you wonder about, that are not effective for, or not good for people.
Well, you know, we're looking, there are several drugs that when you give a variety of animals, they would live healthier and longer, and some of them are in human use. Statin is not one of them. Okay, statin doesn't interact with the biology of aging. Statin is very specific for the risk, to decrease the risk for cardiovascular disease. And in fact, if you look at what happens with statin, it will prevent myocardial infarction. It also will prevent mortality, cardiovascular mortality. But it's not going to change overall mortality. Think of that. You get the statin, you get all the benefits of heart, you die less from heart disease, but you don't die less overall. How is it possible? Well, because, for example, statin causes diabetes. It's a 50% risk of getting diabetes. Statin might be lowering the cholesterol too much that the cognitive function can be changed. So I'm not saying the statin shouldn't be a medication for that risk factor, but you have to distinct what can really use to change the biology of aging versus what is used for specific indications?
Well, it's sort of the distinction between diseases of aging, such as heart disease, diabetes, cancer, and then the underlying process of aging that increases the risk for all of those things. So one thing I found in my research was that if you knock down one disease or two diseases, you know, people run into the third disease. So you don't really extend lifespan or healthy lifespan all that much. So the idea is to tackle the underlying biology of aging. Let's see if you can tweak that.
A lot of the things, you have a bunch of really, the book is cool because it has so many different approaches to aging and things that might be interesting in that way. And one of them you come back to again and again is eating less, caloric restriction, or fasting, or those directions.
Right, and it's somewhat unfortunate, but one of the first discoveries, the first ways to affect the aging process that anybody discovered was by feeding mice or rats less, like a lot less, like 30% less. And this guy at Cornell in the 30s found that they lived a lot longer. And since then, that's been sort of one of the dominant paradigms, sort of looking at the effect of metabolism on longevity. And it's sort of weird that you'd think that if you ate more, you'd do better. But actually, if you eat less, you do better. And I think it's built into our biology so that we could survive periods of famine, periods without food, periods when we're not very good at hunting, and to continue until we did get something.
And in your study, it's interesting that you recount in the book, you're talking to Jewish centenarians in this area who have terrible diets and live to incredible ages.
Right, because the people who are 100 years old, almost 50% of them were overweight or obese. 60% of the men were, and 30% of the women were smoking for, two packs for over 30 years. Moderate exercising, I'm talking about housework and walking, less than 50% of the people. Vegetarian, only 2.7% of our population. But the point here is that they have longevity genes that are protecting them against the environment. And that's not designed to tell you to start smoking and be obese and all that, right? That's very specifically for them. I would say that if any one of you will smoke for 90 years, you live a long life, okay? But only those guys that are protected against that can do that, and that's what we're trying to imitate. Let me just make a comment about the caloric restriction, because I want to have a very optimistic point of view here. We found out later, I think you're writing it in the book, that the caloric restriction depend on the genetic backgrounds, right? Nelson's study. So he took 40 different strains of mice and gave them caloric restriction. And guess what? Half of them died faster and half of them lived longer. So the genetic background is important. So why is it important for you? Because in humans, in men and women, in all ages, the lowest mortality is when you're overweight. You have higher mortality when you're obese, which is a problem because most of us are tending, or that's the problem in our society. Not most of us, because I even can see here that there are not many obese people here. But also when you're lean, there is an increase in almost all causes of death. So if you're overweight, okay, that's probably the setup for genetics for human. So we don't really, and by the way, if it wasn't true and caloric restriction was the right thing to do, it would be a real big problem, right, for you, for us, to start eating much less. That's really very tough.
I want to turn this over to the audience, but I'd like some questions. But one thing I'd like to get into is this whole idea that one of the things that the film is really, is an assumption of the film, and is just the whole idea that aging is a horrible thing. And just want to discuss for a moment the degree to which our conception of aging is really very culture-bound as being something which we've made terrible. I mean, it's not as horrible in other cultures. I mean, it's not something which is attended by as a medical gauntlet before you go, before you die, and where you're basically housed in warehouses into nursing homes, and you've lost all sort of social function and no sort of real, sort of, there's no sort of social status or, I mean, you really, it is something which, I understand it, that why we all really recoil at the idea of aging, but it's really, but that's something which is not, hasn't always been the case. I mean, not that people love going to their grave, but there is something that we've made really horrible about aging in this culture.
Well, so Montaigne said that to die of old age in his day was the extremest sort of dying, and now those diseases kill, 80% of us? We die of some sort of disease of old age. But Montaigne also said that the real kind of tragedy of aging is that not that it kills somebody when they're old, but that it takes a young person and transforms them into an old person. So it sort of like robs you of your youth. And that's sort of the first crime. Not so much the dying when you're old.
Unless it affects your memory and then you don't remember your youth. But I really, never mind that. I really want to say, I mean, let that stand, but I really want to pick on part of what Bill was saying in the book, and that is that we have been able to extend healthy lifespan of many models, by genetic modulation, by drug interventions, by the environmental intervention like caloric restriction. And part of those have been done with drugs that are in human use, not for this specific indication, but in use. So we think that we understand enough the biology and can modulate enough the biology in order to intervene and extend health span. This is something that we believe we've done all the preclinical data. We've done as much studies as it would take to get a drug into treating diabetes or cardiovascular disease or others. So I think, you know, aging is associated with disability and chronic debilitating diseases and stuff, but it's not something that cannot be modulated.
And do you think that's going to be modulated more by lifestyle changes or more by more medication?
So we launched today, Bill was there, we launched today with the American Federation of Aging Research a setup for a trial. And I have to tell you this, there is a frustration. I said we can do it. The frustration is that the Food and Drug Administration doesn't recognize aging as a target, okay? If the FDA doesn't recognize aging as a target, the pharmaceuticals are not going to jump over and develop the drugs. So we need to change the FDA indication. And in order to change with the FDA indication, we came up with a novel study where we're using a pretty common and safe drug, and we believe that we're going to show in several years that we can change that we can change the rate of aging and get an indication, and then I think we're going to benefit as a society a lot from such an intervention. The drug is metformin. Is somebody here on metformin? So those of you who are metformin, I assume that both of you, maybe there are more, have diabetes. One of the most recent studies showed that people with diabetes on metformin have 15% less mortality than people without diabetes and without metformin. Okay?
And this,
please take care of your retirement and make sure that you have enough money for...
If I could just add on the lifestyle end of things, one of the most interesting things I learned was that one of the longest-lived laboratory mice ever observed was this little guy named Charlie, and his handler gave him a bigger cage and put little things in it to prune to play with and change the toys and change the environment and played with him every day and sort of took care of him. And he lived an astonishingly long period of time. He lived nearly 5 years.
Yeah.
So imagine if he had taken metformin, he'd do it better.
I think the mic is in the back. Okay.
Please wait for the mic.
There's a mic that will come around to you.
Doctor, you kind of said that in your, I'm over here, in your studies of people who live a long time, that lifestyle didn't seem to be a factor, and that genetics seemed to be the strongest factor. And correct me if I'm wrong, but people are living markedly longer as each generation, follows the next. Is that plainly evolutionary?
Is the fact that we're living longer evolutionary? Let me say something very clear about evolution and aging. You know, evolution is all about how the fetus survive in order to get their genetic content into their offspring, right? Aging is so much post-reproduction. It happens so many years later that really we don't think of aging as part of evolution, but rather as an afterthought of evolution. It is possible that some of the things that leads us to the ability to reproduce and reproduce healthy is also staying, you know, those who have the best reproduction also will have the better aging. But there's exactly an opposing hypothesis that is called the antagonistic pleiotrophy hypothesis, where actually some of the things that are needed for reproduction are going to be against you when you age. For example, for reproduction, you need a big cholesterol metabolism because there's lots of those membranes that you have to start, but maybe if you have high cholesterol when you're aging, it's going to kill you. So just to tell you, it's not evolution. What happens, the fact that we have more old people is because we dealt with infant mortality, so there are not that many young people that are dying anymore, and we push the population into aging, and so we have more people who are age, and of them, there's a certain percentage that get to be older and older. Our concern in the study is how many of the 100 years old are kind of bionic. You know, they have pacemaker and hip replacement and other things. They're not the naturally occurring centenarians. But I would say even if you're kind of bionic, to get to 100 is pretty nice accomplishment, and they're usually doing well.
Okay, so how does this Alzheimer's relate to telomeres and the health of aging?
How does Alzheimer's relate to telomeres?
Oh, how telomeres. Alzheimer's
yeah,
relate.
Right. Because what's the sense of being 97 if at 91 you're not in your good state of mind?
Well, that kind of goes back to this idea that the diseases of aging are kind of like this gauntlet that you run, and you know, if you get by heart disease, diabetes, cancer, then there's Alzheimer's waiting for you. But there's been, which is terrible. But so, again, some of the interesting research I came across was work that derived from a technique called parabiosis, where they basically surgically join a younger and an older animal. And sort of long story short, they've found factors in younger blood that seem to restore the kind of connectivity of older neurons. And there's some hope there that might, you know, lead to treatments not only for Alzheimer's, but also heart disease.
Right, we have a core that that provide you for $500. Parabiosis, those are two young mice that are attached to each other, so they join circulation. two old ones, and then a young and an old together. And we're watching how the young becomes a little older and how the old becomes a little younger. But we made really very fascinating discoveries for that. But if you want to use the core, please write me a proposal.
Question, ready?
Mike's in the back.
Is it true that there seems to be no clear definition of aging? And how is aging separated from the disease process that causes people to die? How is that being defined?
Well, I sort of chuckled a little bit at the when the anti-aging physician came on the screen, and it's sort of how can you be an anti-aging doctor if there's not really a good way to measure aging, right? You can't. There's not a suite of biomarkers that you can tell me that my real age is 29 or 59.
Well, in fact, this is why you define those people as charlatans. Because you go to them because you want to be immortalized, and they come to you and immediately tell you that you're 19 and 20 years younger, right? How is that possible? And those guys believed them. they're in competition, right? Somebody that tells you you're 20 years younger, are you buying what he wants to say next? But
sounds good to me.
but you know, the definition, you said, what's the biological definition? You know, the biological definition of aging.
What is your definition of aging?
So,
or aged?
So I'll tell you, I'm not very good at definition. There's a lot of definition of aging that it depends who you ask. Do you ask a geriatrician, or do you ask a biologist? And the answers are not going to be so simple, right? They're not going to be so simple. And the biology of aging, we know the major hubs there, and we can, in a very long paragraph, include them, but this is not completed either. But we kind of know what it is with, what's the example when you know when
that was pornography.
Pornography, right? You know what it is when you see that. So, which, by the way, that's not any comment about the movie. Okay. And by the way, I thought the movie was really great. I thought the movie was really great. I liked everything about it. I liked the animation, and I liked the fact that you can still judge for yourself. You know, there's no judgment in the movie. You got all the facts, and you can decide for yourself about the not only the enthusiasm, but who of them is more sincere or less sincere. And it was just really well done. I really enjoyed it. And you see, it's a thing that we can discuss.
So the Phil mentioned it, but you talked about there's some sociological implications in what you're doing, and I know that would be hours for you to address, but if you could just touch on a few of them, like we all get older, which is wonderful, the implications to the medical profession, nursing homes, our children taking care of us, Medicare and Medicaid going, or Medicare and Social Security going, you know, up. How do you address, or is someone working on the sociological and cultural implications of us getting older?
We happen to have an expert on that in the house.
Yeah, we have Jael Shansky from University of Illinois, that is one of the leading gerontologists that took a ride with me because he heard that this movie is on. And that's not the only question that he's an expert on. We answered some of them, I hope, right, but please, Jay.
All right, so I'm a professor of public health at the University of Illinois, and the question that you asked is a critically important one, as you might imagine. So as it turns out, we published a manuscript on this about a year and a half ago on the implications of what happens if we succeed in finding a way to slow aging. And you're absolutely right. There's no question that, and I shouldn't say if, I should say when, there's a successful effort to modulate aging, we will have to pay a price. Now that price is there are going to be many more healthy older people that survive beyond the age of 65, which means the entitlement programs are going to be challenged. I mean, look, there's no question. But I have to tell you that the same thing would happen if we find a cure for cancer. I assume you're not against finding a cure for cancer. The same thing would happen if we found a cure for heart disease. I assume you're not against the idea of finding a cure for heart disease. What's being proposed here in aging science is an intervention that modulates all fatal and disabling diseases simultaneously. So you're right, there would be a price we would have to pay. We would live longer, healthier lives, and more of us would live past the age of 65. You're absolutely right. Now, in our manuscript, we actually fixed the problem. So it's a longer explanation of how you fix Social Security to handle this issue, and I can tell you that we've got another paper coming out in Daedalus in about 2 months that is going to deal explicitly with the issue of Social Security.
But Jay, can you tell us what's the cost saving for the society for being healthy from now to, right, I don't know, 2050?
So the cost savings, if we achieve a minor deceleration in the rate of biological aging, and I mean a minor one, and the way you should interpret that is you would simultaneously experience a lowered risk of all major fatal diseases at once, all disabling diseases at once, including Alzheimer's, by the way. And the estimated cost savings would be about $7.1 trillion between now and 2050. But I know the cost savings is important, but I'm actually much more interested in the health savings and how much more healthy we would be as a result. If I can make one point about the movie, because I know you were happy with it, or maybe you were happy with it. Look, I have perhaps debated Aubrey more than anyone else in the world, numerous times. And I just have to tell you, you have been misled.
Why weren't you in the movie?
I've been in others.
Len
Hayflick, I mean, Len Hayflick, you know, made a lot of sense in this particular movie. But look, at a meeting that Aubrey and I were at just a few months ago, this whole idea of immortality, radical life extension, was out the door. He said, this is not what we are trying to pursue. We are not trying to pursue immortality. We are not trying to pursue radical life extension. We are trying to extend the period of healthy life, exactly what Nir was talking about. And this whole movie, all of the language about immortality, about 1,000-year lifespans, is complete nonsense. And I'm really disappointed in Aubrey, to be honest with you, when he says one thing in front of one group and something else in front of somebody else. And he's telling people what they want to hear, and he's a close friend of mine. I have to tell you, Aubrey and I have been having fun and debate. We don't drink together, but we've been debating for a long time, and you have been misled by this movie.
But I think he changed his mind after he started caring for three different women. I think that's what
I mean.
Okay, we're gonna take a couple of more questions, and then we're gonna go to the book signing with Bill.
Okay, hello. I had just a general conservative timeline question from the experts here for three things. If we could do some sort of gene therapy so we could all enjoy the long telomeres, or at least our progeny could enjoy them. Is that 2040, is that 2070 in your experience? And also what Aubrey de Grey was talking about, even conservatively, building enzymes or nanotechnology to eat the intracellular junk, would that be 2050, 2070? So, thank you.
I'm not sure I understood the question, but part of it you said, is the garbage theory correct?
Well, if it's possible, with how long off are we talking about to be coming into that market?
Well, I don't know to give thing, but the garbage theory is one of the most important theory for cellular aging, and at Einstein we have probably the most prominent scientist, Ana Maria Cuervo, that has targeted a process in the cell that's called autophagy, where the cell really eats itself, but it eats itself in order to, in some way, to protect from the macromolecules and the damaged molecules, which were explained in the movie. And this is truly one of the major approaches for cell survivor. So there, in those seven things that he did, actually, not all the seven things were discussed, but this thing is really one of the major, on the cellular level, it's one of the major thing that has promise and also has efforts for drug development.
So he's right about that?
Yeah. Well, but that's not going to immortalize us, okay?
True. Yeah. I mean, I thought this was a wonderful movie on a wholly different level. I mean, apart from the science, which we've been questioning and debating, but it just gets to, it's really about these guys' sort of personal struggles with the idea of death and aging. And that's something that kind of we all have to face, either as publicly and, you know, wackily as they do, or sort of privately. And it's something that, you know, it's kind of like haunted our species since the beginning. And now that more and more of us are dealing with aging rather than getting killed by a rock falling on our head or falling off a cliff or disease or wherever we died in previous centuries. So I think it's sort of very kind of relevant on that level.
I agree. I think it's a really good portrait of exactly what it sets out to do. And it may be, obviously, you know Aubrey, and you've had fascinating debates with him. I wish one criticism of the film is I would have liked to have heard more of that debate. That was up there, because I imagine they're both super articulate guys.
It's on YouTube.
What?
It's on YouTube.
Oh. So last question here.
Dr. Barzilai, I want to get back to when you talked about measuring one's biologic aging and that's really not possible.
Karen?
Yes, it is. Hi. Karen. Should I say that I work at Einstein with you? With regard to your research of the centenarians, one of the things that you have observed is that a lot of the centenarians seem to age more slowly. It's not that they have a different biological age. Can you talk about that a little bit? I think that might interest folks.
Yeah, I mean, it's very simple. I asked you questions before. Tell
me, use the mic.
Who of you, I'm going to take a vote. Is humans aging different between people? Do you know people who age slower than others? Do you know people who age faster than others? Do you know somebody who's 50 who looks like who's 40? Do you know somebody who's 50 who looks like 60? If you think that we human aged at different rates, raise your hands and everybody looks around. Okay, this is right before I divided you a bit. This is always, it thrills me always to see this 100% that intuitively know that we age at different rates. And what we haven't done is we haven't really looked at why some people are aging so slower than others. And that's pretty much what I'm trying to do. And so I'm assuming that 100 years old are, their aging is slowing the most, and we have made some discoveries, and we actually have development of drugs based on our studies that kind of explain and may be applicable to really modulate the rate of aging. And it's very important to know that we have it inside of us and it can be discovered today.
So I think we're going to have Bill Gifford is here to sign books as well. We can purchase them right up front. And so I just want to thank you all for coming. I think this is really-